Okay, next you have the option as to whether you build the 10 points that we create by default and have created by default for quite a while on the Pi system for testing purposes. These are tags like sinusoid and CDT158. These are tags we're really familiar with in training because we use them all the time, you know, to produce our generic training material. You'll see a lot of our examples are based on those default points. And they're generated by our random interface for generating random data, also the RampSoak simulator. Anyway, these points, they do consume, you know, 10 points. And if you don't want those to be consumed, you can go ahead and just clear this. But we do strongly suggest you keep these default points. They're a great troubleshooting tool. I mean, it's very easy. When somebody calls up and says, hey, I can't see anything for history for my OPC interface, the first thing we do is try to do a trend of sinusoid. And if we can't see the OPC server tags, but we can see sinusoid in the history, that means you've narrowed it down to an interface problem, not an archive or a security problem. So we suggest you keep those. Now, secondly, we also have this option for whether Pi starts automatically on reboot. And typically, that's what you would want. Every time you restart the operating system, you have a power failure and it's 3 in the morning. You don't want to get a phone call at 3:30 in the morning saying, hey, we had a power failure a half an hour ago and Pi hasn't restarted. You would like Pi to automatically restart. So we suggest you keep this. Just a footnote, though. This brings up the whole issue of services. If you ever have to shut down the Pi server, when you do have to shut down your computer, we do suggest you shut down the Pi server first using the tools that are in the system management directory. And we'll go over that later on. So while we're talking about starting up and shutting down, it's a good rule of thumb to shut down Pi first before you shut the computer down. Shutting the computer down without shutting down Pi first, it does, on some versions, it does have the leave you to a vulnerability where you may actually shut the computer down before all the services in Pi have had a chance to wind down gracefully. So minor point, but I thought I'd mention it right now. Now, next up, we get to specify where the archive path is, where the archives are going to be stored. So we haven't gotten into it, but suffice it to say that there are files, large files called archives. There are 3 of them that are going to be created by default. And this is where we store the historical data. Now, typically, they go into the Pi directory under the DAT subdirectory, and that's a fine place to put them. Now, if you do want to move these to a different location, again, if you've got a drive D that has more resources available to it, that's not a bad option. So consider moving that. Really, only if you've got the extra space available, or if you've got like a SanDisk that's extremely fast, then you can go ahead and move those archives there. Now, when it comes to the archive size, though, with regard to archive size, we don't have a lot to say other than, you know, we're trying to make sure that the archives are going to be sized appropriately for the amount of data you're going to be storing in them on a daily basis. So how do you make that calculation? Well, let me show you in our tech support page. Let me show you some of the, how we try to resolve this for folks. Let me go back to our main tech support page. And if we go to tech support, I'll just do a search for archive sizing. We have a nice little article here that explains, you know, some of the archive sizing considerations. This is where we would go we suggest you go if you don't want to accept the default sizes of the archives. So as you can see, as we scroll down through here, there's a lot of good information, a lot of advice on this. It's, you know, the system's very, very flexible. So depending on what your data rates are, you could have different answers for this question. And as you can see, here's a knowledge base article on how to calculate archive and disk consumption for a Pi3 server so that you know what kind of data rates you might be able to get before you actually, you know, do the actual test yourself. What I would recommend is go ahead and do the sizing or accept the defaults that we see right here, but then check back and take a look using the system management tools we're going to look at later in class. Take a look at what you're storing in each individual archives in terms of how many days worth of data. And we're shooting for something like, maybe 5 days to 2 weeks worth of data per archive, something that is going to be manageable so that you're not backing it up too much, and something where you're not putting all your eggs in one basket. You know, you don't want an archive size so small that you're storing 3-4 weeks of data, maybe a couple of months of data in one archive. There are people who accidentally delete their archives, and you know, it's just human error that can crop up. So for that reason, even though you might be able to store years worth of data or months worth of data in one archive, it's not a good idea to put it all in just a single file that could get corrupted or somebody could forget to back it up. Now, next up is this advanced option. The advanced option gives you the choice of what you do for a certain internal settings, the event queue size and the event queue page size. And what we're talking about here is, the event queue is used in cases where the archive is unavailable. We can buffer things temporarily in the event queue. And our recommendation is to make this half the size of the archive. As you can see, that's what it is already. If I look at my archive, it's 256 megabytes. So we've set this up at half that size. What our general rule of thumb for the event queue size is make it big enough to accept or be able to hold 1 day's worth of data. So, and again, you're not going to know what 1 day's worth of data is for you on disk until you start collecting data. So that's something that you can accept the default, and then later on through some Pi system management tools, you can make a change to this if you need to. Now, the event queue page size really has one impact, and that is it is the boundary of what you can store in a single annotation. I shouldn't say it only has one impact, but that's the thing that might affect you, other than some subtle performance differences. So the event queue page size is going to limit the size of your annotations. Now, 1024 bytes or 1K, that's big enough for most people's uses, but if for some reason you've got very large annotations that you need to do to your Pi data, then you can make this larger to accommodate that. The general rule of thumb here is to leave these the default, because we really don't expect anybody to change this unless there's some problem. So, unless you know in advance, you've got very unusual kind of profile of how much data you're bringing in and the size of that data, I would leave these two alone. Okay, I'll go ahead and proceed. Now, what you're going to be seeing here is these are all the different components of the Pi system being installed one at a time. The different interfaces. We have several interfaces for test purposes, several interfaces for IT monitoring purposes, like this SNMP and the ping and the performance monitor interface. These are all basic versions that everybody gets access to. And so as you can see, they're being installed, and we'll look at those later on. Okay, it looks like we've got a complete install. Everything looks good. And next, we'll take a look at the structure that's just been created. Incidentally, under Program Files, in the PyPC directory, you'll find a log file. That's under PyPC/stat. It's this PyServer master log. So you see, this is there's a variety of logs there from the install. This is the master log that's going to tell you just about everything that happened during that install.